right? Pretty much covered the spectrum. Some are easier than others. Actually, kindergarten is still the hardest by far. Any kindergarten teachers here? Yeah, really hard. They're hard in the back. I've worked in Canada, Togo, Taiwan, Qatar, Jamaica, Indonesia, Singapore, Timor Leste, and now I'm in Japan. And I didn't get fired every time. It was a conscious choice to move. Because that when I left Canada, I set out to like see the world. So I spent 2 years in Qatar, which was an interesting experience. Very hot. Very, very hot. But back in the days when the most exciting thing in Doha was the Dairy Queen. Apparently Doha is a very different place now. And actually since 2000 I've been involved with the International Baccalaureate. Has anyone ever heard of the International Baccalaureate with the IB? Okay. Are there any IB teachers here? It's been a really great experience because through the IB, it's like a global community of teachers, and every time you go to an event, you see somebody that you've worked with in some foreign country somewhere. And because of that, I was recently, 2 years ago, I was hired at the University of Tsukuba in Ibaraki, Japan. It's Japan's third largest university and the biggest teacher training university because the government of Japan has decided they want 200 IB schools in their public system by 2019. Right now they have six, so it's a pretty big order. But they needed to develop a teacher training program for teachers to teach in these 200 schools because the distance between traditional Japanese curriculum and not just the IB, but concept-driven inquiry type of curriculum is huge. And it's not an easy transition to move between the two. And I've also done work with Saudi government in developing teacher training programs there and the Malaysian government. Also governmental programs that are moving to the IB. A little bit about who are you? So just maybe by show of hands, it's too big to introduce. So how many Egyptian nationals? How many non-national Egyptians? Oh, I'm sorry, non-Egyptian and non-Egyptian national. Okay, just a couple, three of those. Okay, how many, we got that expression, how many elementary school teachers? How many middle school teachers? Three, so high school teachers? Okay, administrators? What about state schools? People that work in state, public or state schools? What? A couple, okay. What about private schools? And private schools that run the Egyptian curriculum? Any international school teachers? Lots of those. Okay. So just so I know, international meaning not Egyptian curriculum, right? Okay, got it. Can those international schools be Egyptian nationals? Can Egyptian nationals be in an international school? Yes. Yes. Great. Okay, just a couple of things about the aims of this session. So I want you to consider the theoretical underpinnings of constructivist learning theory and investigate some of the key features of a learning environment that supports constructivism and some of the key features of pedagogical strategies which do that as well. So that's, we're going to be talking about constructivism. And kind of a fundamental tenet of approaches to constructivist teaching and learning is that you have to recognize and appreciate prior understanding and prior knowledge. So what I'd like you to do just at your table for a couple of seconds is have a chat and you can jot down some notes if you need to, and then we'll just get people to report out a couple of big findings from their table. What's your understanding of constructivist learning theory? How is it different than more traditional transmission models of teaching and learning? What does it look like? And what kind of learning environment does this need? So I think this morning's keynote was really interesting because he touched on a lot of those things, like spaces make a big difference, and to conversations, and it's a really good session. Brought a lot of things together. Okay, so I'm going to give you about 4 minutes to have that discussion around the table. I'm probably, you could Google it, but it's better if you don't Google it. It's not cheating, right? There's no cheating.
Basically, there are some concepts like the zone of proximity development, which is basically it is the zone between what the learner
to everyone here, to myself, is that we can rethink and we can do better. And here's what better might look like. Okay. So this is the slide that I call the don't freak out slide.
Yeah.
Because we don't, I don't think anybody works in this school or similar to it, I certainly do not. And what we work in is spaces that have a historical legacy. People before us, teachers before us, have made choices for us. And we have to come in and kind of figure it out. And if you've ever moved into a new classroom, you know that there's that whole period of time where you're sort of trying to work out how will this room work, where will the kids put their fingers, where will their this book be, or where will their computers be. And we try to get used to space. When you start from a clean slate, this is the sort of spaces that are being built today. This is the work of a designer, an artist and a designer called Roseanne Bosch. And she has got an excellent TED talk. If you have access to TED Talk, I'm not sure if it's on YouTube or what the story is. But Roseanne Bosch is her name. And I'll play that TED talk in tomorrow's session if you're interested in any good comment. So why do they look different? Is it because materials are different? Is it simply because, oh, it's the modern age, we've got better synthetics? No, there's thinking behind this that is really important for educators to grapple with.
The way you how many kids would fit in a room like this?
Yeah. Well, the thing you probably can't tell is that it's one space. And when you look at the floor plan of this space, it's just a long, open area, all of these deliberate sections. Yeah, it's amazing. Alrighty, so I'll take a pause from me. That was a mini lecture. Could you just turn and talk, please, to somebody next to you? Say hello if you haven't met them before. And I just invite you to mention what is the most important thing that we just covered as I've been inspired to you.
How many times?
And why is this different in space?
Diagrams, and I'm inviting you to, as you put it all together in the end, to see where your ideas could fit. Welcome, guys. Come on in, please. Oh, that should work as well. I'm not sure how big they are here. I've never worked with them before. That's no problem. So if you type in to your web browser, HTTP, a normal site to any website, there's bit.ly. And then this last code here, this is a lowercase L.
John Hattie has, you know, collected a lot of data. It's been proven that academic success is actually augmented when students have an authentic learning experience in the community to fully develop their understanding of a concept or an issue. So, it could be something to do with water scarcity, or if they're learning about poverty or roots of poverty. Or it could be gender equity issues. If they're engaged and learning with a partner on the local level, they will perform better in a test on that subject. They will understand the content at a far deeper level. Shall we just leave it? It wants to lie on the floor, doesn't it? So you can see this Venn diagram. These are all of the components, what is involved in service learning. And then we move on to the focus. Ahmed? Excuse me, Ahmed? Ahmed Hassan.
It's okay, it's both.
Okay. Hassan.
My bad. My is the nicest Hassan that I have.
He just told me to call him Hero, so, maybe I'll just call him Hero. So, as you can see, this is an equilateral triangle. Is that right, maths teachers?
Yes.
I remember something from GCSEs. Phew! So, all of these stakeholders play an equal part, but students, from my experience, if students can own the process, if you create opportunities for students to feel the benefits, they can drive that triangle, okay? So that's why I've put them at the top, even though it's an equilateral triangle. They can really drive processes and create a culture of service learning at school. I've seen it. It's true.
I think the students should be inside the triangle.
Pardon? Yeah, maybe. I think this space is for perhaps like the project and the learning, but yeah. Or maybe I could just put like a steering wheel in the middle. That's a good suggestion, thank you. Okay, so what I've tried to do is just give a few takeaways, like a few strategies and suggestions that you can take away immediately to implement. There will be some time for you to talk about student leaders perhaps in your school or projects. It might be a community service project right now, but they can often be transformed into service learning experiences. So what I'm going to try to do now, I've prioritized four kind of top tips for supporting student leaders, for creating the conditions for them to run with an idea, but in an informed and thoughtful way. It's not like, oh my god, I just watched a documentary about the melting ice caps. I'm gonna sell cakes tomorrow and send the proceeds to Greenpeace. Brilliant, we've got the passion. I'm listening, student. But it's in a vacuum. We must model thoughtful, informed approaches to this type of experiential learning. Okay? So, that is the question that we'll be fostering. Also, you'll notice that the images of students I've worked with over the past 10 years, in moments where I feel they're really engaging in their learning, showing leadership skills, and gaining a deeper understanding of some important global issues. Right, so firstly, and this is not rocket science, and this will serve as a reminder, I think, but I think it's important to just sometimes state the obvious. And just put it back on our radars, because we get so carried away. They need to be prepared for that assessment, and we have to do this, that, and this. We forget the basics. Students are so open, I find. Young people are open to ideas. They're easily impressed. They can get inspired. Yes, that student really cares about the melting ice cap so much that they want to do something straight away. So, inspiring through storytelling and real-life examples is key. I spend a lot of time sharing examples of young people and adults making change in communities. We all know Malala, she needs no introduction. Does anybody know this gentleman? He's a Brazilian photographer called Sebastião Salgado. And it blew my mind. I showed a TED talk. It was called The Silent Drama of Photography. And he's got a very interesting story. He was an economist. Do we have other economists in the room? Wonderful. And then he had a very high profile job. He got very sick. He's from a rural area of Brazil that he just, the environment had degraded over a period of time, deforestation was massive, and he had this massive kind of light bulb moment. And anyway, in this TED talk, he just tells his story about having spent the first half of his photography career taking photos of brutalities. He was in Rwanda in 94. He'd been in positions of extreme conflict and extreme poverty and was capturing this beautifully, but he felt it was making him sick. And so actually what he decided to do was document all of the beautiful things about our world. So he just flipped it. Anyway, I do recommend there are resources on here. But I played that video to students and I saw it was mind-blowing how quick it's like, oh well, we shouldn't be making them feel guilty about having more than those hits at Ngurahati. We should be celebrating, how much those hits have got and how much we have and meet. It was just like, is the glass half full or half empty? A quick switch, and that was only through just sharing Salgado's story. Sometimes it can be as simple as that. And I think that's important to remember. Another thing, we need to think of ourselves as guides and mentors rather than teachers. Guide students through processes. This is the service learning cycle that actually the IB have adopted as the CAS stages for the CAS project and the new CAS cadres. Do we have any CAS coordinators here? Yeah, anyone is a CAS coordinator too. So this service learning cycle is informed. This looks familiar, hey?
Yeah. Just finished the training last summer.
Oh, wonderful.
Very familiar.
Great. If you want to talk CAS, we can talk CAS later. I've got tons of resources.
أكتر من كده وأفضل من كده ولو إحنا وقفنا فعلا على أطفالنا خاصة في مرحلة التعليم الأساسي سواء كانت مرحلة الابتدائية أو ما قبل المرحلة الابتدائية لو إحنا فعلا عملنا سجل تقييم لكل طفل هنطلع حاجات اجمل من كده بكتير من اطفالنا، لان انا اعتبر ان الطفل المصري ده اذكى طفل في العالم واحسن طفل على مستوى العالم. شكرا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته. طبعا من بين برضك الحاجات اللي انا حصينا ان هم بيندبونا او الساده المحاضرين الى ان اقرا باسم ربك الذي خلق. خلاص؟ وثبت علميا والكلام ده عن تجربه انا كنت بعمل بيها. ان الولد لو اجاد القراءه قبل سن دخول المدرسه بيفضل متفوق على طول.
انا ما اقرا
القراءه. انا الكلام ده انا سمعته بره. خلاص؟ احنا بنتكلم على اساس ان احنا عايزين نرتقي باولادنا. فكيفية الارتقاء بالاولاد لازم هو يتعامل بالقراءة والكتابة، مفيش مشاكل انه يتعامل بأي لغة تانية، يتعامل بأي وسيلة.
لا اعقد بس على حد طلعت التليفون، بس خليني اعقد لانه هذه مزاحمة جدا حساسة. أول شيء شكرا لك وقرأيك على راسي. اللي بريد أن أؤكد عليه بأنه التعليم التحدث والاستماع حسب الدراسات وحسب دراستي أنا في الدكتوراه يأتي سابقا. فأنت لا تستطيع أن تعلم طفلاً إذا لم يكن يملك لغة محكية. انطلاقاً منها نأتي إلى إقرأ. إقرأ في القرآن الله سبحانه وتعالى قال إقرأ ولم يقر فقط التهجئة بإعداد القراءة والسماعية. مش هندخل في القرائية الآن. ملعبي بقى. يلا حاضر حاضر. لكن أنا أريد أن أؤكد بأن الإقرأ اللي هو عي من الوعي. انتبه. فسر. حلل كلها هذه اللي هو اللي جاء فيها بلوم يعني هو هذا موجود عندنا.
استاذ مدرب معلش انا معاك سلبيه صغيره. لو نظرنا الى التصرف من التربيه والتعليم هنلاقيه كله مبني على ترك القراءه من الصغر.
صحيح.
ولكن الامر ده والامر ده يا جماعه التصرف الدراسي اساسه عدم تعليم الولد القراءه والكتابه والحساب من البدايه. معلش.
طيب يلا حاضر
يا
ساره. حاضر
حبيبي
دقيقه بس
اسمع لها. يعني بعد اذن حضرتك دكتور مخلص حسنين وكيل اداره العشره التعليميه. وبالنسبه للاخ اللي اتكلم معلش ولو نقطه بس تسمح حضرتك صغيره خالص. هو اي لغه في الدنيا ليها اربع مهارات فور سكيلز سبيكينج ورايتنج وريدنج وليسننج. فاقرا مش معناها اكتب. اقرا مش معناها ان انت تمسك القلم وانت لسه في سن صغير وعضلاتك ضعيفه وتمسك القلم وتكتب. لا ده خطك نازل مع السطر واضربه وعقله واحسسه ان المدرسه مصدر للقلم بدل ما تكون مصدر للتعلم. الحياه مدرسه والتعلم عن طريق وربنا سبحانه وتعالى امرنا بالتفكر والنظر والتدبر ودي كلها ضمن اقرا. دي نقطه. اما بالنسبه لموضوعنا النهارده اللي هو موضوع اللعب ده موضوع ممتاز جدا جدا جدا. واللعب طبعا بالتقسيمات اللي الدكتوره قالت عليها ده ممتاز. ولكن طبعا اللعب لا بد ان يكون موجها وطبعا معد له مسبقا ومعروف ايه النتائج اللي هتؤدي اليها هذه اللعبه والحاجات اللي بنسيبها في طريق الاطفال لازم تكون طبعا حاجات موجهه ومدروسه. واللي شفنا هنا اللي دخلت وكتبت بعض الملاحظات هي خارج الاطار اللي فيه الاطفال. هي في مكان تاني. يعني احنا ممكن نفهم ان هي دخلت والاطفال مش شايفه ربوها واستمروا في اللعب. لا طبعا هي في مكان تاني وبتقيم من بعيد بتقيم عن طريق الملاحظات.
طيب شكرا لمداخلاتكم. انا اعتذر كثيرا عن ساره اسمعك لكن بيرتي وجهه لصديقتي. يلا.
دايما ساره صديقتي ما قصدتش هنا اقف السلام. اذا بتكلمش بيسا اخصائيه نفسيه. هي فكره انه خوفنا ممكن يكون خوفنا الزياده عن الاطفال او الحمايه الزايده هي اللي بتخلينا دايما نخاف عليهم ان هم يجربوا من ان هم يبتكروا من ان هم يلمسوا الحاجه. يعني هنا ازاي طفل ماسك شاكوش وماسك خشب لو طفل عمل كده ممكن خوفي الزياده عليه يمنعه من ان هو يجرب وده يمنع عنه باب جديد للتعلم. اكيد
نقطه جدا ضروريه ولازم تبقى عليها في المدارس اللي هي سلامه الطفل تاتي قبل التعليمات. انا اعلم ذلك. لكن في شيء ايضا انا ليس يعني انا اعطيتكم هذا كنموذج لما يحدث في العالم. فهل يعني في المدارس هو هذا السؤال؟ في اشياء تحدث واشياء لا تحدث. هنا لما يعطيك الممارسه الخبرات المفتوحه للطفل غالبا تكون موجهه لما يكون دافعيه الطفل. يعني انا اليوم جاي بمزاجي احضر ريما. تلقيك الخاص من ريما حيكون مختلف تماما لما مديرتك تقول لك لا روح احضر ريما. ولما انا اتصل بقول لك اسمعي انا عندي كذا تعالي. لا انت مش جاي تطيب خاطرك، انت جاي عندك ما تسميه الاونرشيب، اللي هو انا اريد ان امتلك القرار ان اتابع. لما الطفل من هو صغير يقرر اين هو، شفتوا البنات اللي بيعملها شعرها بالبنت؟ طب احنا عاده البنات اللي بتشتغل هذه الاشياء مش الاولاد، لا الولد بنص البين مقفر كويس. ال ابني في الصف السابع اول مره يمسك ابره وخيط كان من يومين في صف الارت. معي انا طرز فلسطين، فلما امسك الابره والخيط انا شايفاه بضل يعني وشايفاه بخيط، ما تخيلش سعادتي، لان هذه المهارات البسيطه احنا بنفقدها عملنا في المدارس هي ضمن اللعب. صح؟ احنا الان حطينا الرياضيات والقراءه والكتابه اهم من الرسم اللي هو اصلا كتابه اوليه، الرسم هي الخريش الاوليه للطفل. مثل الكلام هي القراءه الاوليه للبشر. القراءه في مفهومها الواسع انك تبدا تستقرئ الشيء وتستكشفه، يعني تحلل هل التفكير اسبق من القراءه ولا القراءه اسبق من التفكير، او قد اقول التهجئه، مين اسبق التفكير ولا التهجئه؟ شكرا. اذا هي هذه القراءه بمعانيها الاوليه. نقاش جدا حلو، بالعكس انا سعيده انه استفدت بكم هذا البعد. السؤال الآتي طبعاً، أوكي، رأينا أنماط اللعب، رأينا شفنا أطفال في وضع طبيعي، في لي صديقات من مصر كنت السنة الماضية مشيت على EduForum 20 وحدة منهم، في وحدة معانا في الفيسبوك دائماً بتحط صور هنا من مصر اسمها هدير هنا مش عارفه، بس دائما عندي العاب للاولاد بتعلمهم اوكي، بس دائما بتجيني افكارها لانه افكارها مثل ما كنا نلعب احنا وصغار بس بتوظفها في التعليم. طبعا ان كان اكبر منكم انا شيء مختلف، بس احنا كنا نلعب ايوه، فكانت تلعبهم بس على عد الارقام وجمعها وهكذا، كثير لطيفه الافكار. طيب ايش اللي بيعمل، ما الذي يجعلنا نعلم بشكل افضل؟ لا، نحن نريد ان نعلمهم الفكره، ليست انه اللعب هو الاساس، هو الفكره كم من اللعب مفيد في التعلم. يعني الان لو عندي انا المشكله، انا يعني بحبش احاضر في مدرجات بس الحمد لله كويسين احنا، لو عندي قاعه مختلفه اكيد سيكون فيها العاب اكثر، يعني اللي هيقدر يلعب الاساسمنت بعد الظهر تقييم ادواته رح في العاب رح نلعبها تعالوا. يعني اشياء بسيطه ممكن تنتهينا. مين منكم يحب ان يلعب؟ مين يلعب شطرنج؟ داما الفطره في الانسان، لذلك الله سبحانه وتعالى ماذا يصف الدنيا؟ انها لعب ولهو، لانه هذه نحن مجبولين عليه. يعني الله سبحانه وتعالى لما يخاطبنا بما خلقنا عليه، اللي هو انه نحب نلعب ونلهو.
Start them in the early years. And that team moves from one year to another, to another, to another, and as they move through the curriculum, they leave behind a legacy. And those teachers with the inertia inherit the legacy, and all of a sudden now, wow, this is easier to do than I thought. So it's a shared vision, but there's a different degrees of motivation to actually achieve that, I think.
Everyone, I guess, should feel the ownership. So I mean, everyone can be I said that the school is a community, so everyone inside this community knows exactly what is he participating with. Even opening the door, I'm opening the door for the team to do this, and that.
Yeah.
So this is the that's it.
I think, and I to some degree, I would I'd come back at you, Chris, and actually say that, that the example from Nanjing about putting student voice and choice at the centre of things, that's their strategy. For 3 years, that's what they're going to work at. And I was back there just this year. That's 2 years after they've done that strategy. And I saw every teacher keep everyone accountable, including kids, that is that really putting voice and choice at the centre of things? In other words, I have never yet to encounter a school where everyone knew the strategy, everyone knew the shared vision. Usually, only these people know the strategy. And so if I asked any, what's your school strategy? I don't know, the people at the top know all that stuff. But when you get all the way down where the whole school community knows what we're trying to do together, and you put it into child-friendly language, you actually start to create a change. But yes, it's really hard work. Without shared vision, I don't think you end up fragmenting.
But I really, I get impatient with this soft, fluffy notion of shared vision. I want to know what we're here to do. We are here to make a difference to students' lives. And sometimes that's about outcome, sometimes it's about developing them as critical citizens. But it's what we do, so it's the purpose that we're here for. And if we have a common purpose, that's what matters in school to me. Bill.
Back at you again. If everybody shares the vision, what's to stop groupthink? If everybody shares the vision and is all on board, what's to stop groupthink? Where actually everybody's then just thinking in the same way. Because certainly my experience, it's really good to have a few people who effectively don't agree, because it actually keeps your feet on the ground. It means you have to constantly think about what it is you do. If everybody agrees, you can sort of go off in a particular direction without a level of criticality there.
Yeah, I would agree with you, but I think the opportunity to actually, often as you achieve a shared vision, you keep pushing it further away. Like as you start to make progress, you realise, oh, we're doing it. That means we could do this. That means we could do that. And I was just trying to sort of put up here, I was mentioning this before to the others, a model that comes out of McKinsey when they looked at developing what are called three horizons. I mean, it's interesting we're looking at new horizons for learning. And in developing strategy, often in the first horizon, we talk about all the tactics you can do. A lot of these things, interview, small groups, observe, like lots of little things that you can start to do. And then in here, you might have a couple of key things that actually connect to the strategy. So these things that you're suggesting, where do those things connect to the school strategy, or not, as the case may be? Where in the current cycle is your school strategy? Are you 3 years in, 2 years in? You know, where are you in that process? But down here is the core objective, right? Which is, and there may be like three of these, you know, big objectives that you're doing. But essentially, that core objective might be, let's put student voice and choice at the centre of everything. That's the point. You keep, as you start to reach it, you go, well, what if that's what we can do now, what if, you know, in 3 years we could be doing something else? So the thing is that it naturally stops groupthink. It stops people just blindly, you know, saying, well, we've done that, great, let's close the book and let's move on.
Does that not have to be a circular process then? Because surely if you're putting student and pupil voice at the centre, then you can't control what this is. So you might have to turn then and change your strategy and tactics again.
Yeah, so it's like 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, and then you come back and review and say, yep.
There was somebody at the back.
Starting back again to the scenario, I mean, the teachers are not confident enough in order to, they don't know, they're totally distracted and don't have the confidence even to lead their own classes. So therefore, with the idea of sharing the vision, until you get them back onto their feet, give them confidence, make them part of the family on board, and then they will be able to criticize the vision and be a bit, be an addition to it, and in fact deviate the ship into a better horizon than you ever thought of. But this is why it's very important at the beginning for a start to share the vision.
Raising the sense of ownership among the team, actually, because where I work, we have this team, and our animal campaign is here, which is community comes first. The community is teachers, or classic neighbors, the students, and the parents, which we call them the community. So, the two things, which is involving the decision-making, actually makes them feel that they are part of it. And the ownership, actually,
So implicit in this conversation, there are three themes that I've heard, and if you're familiar with the work of Daniel Pink, and if you've read Drive, mastery, autonomy, and purpose were sort of the key factors in motivation. And while we explicitly said purpose, as you were talking, I was thinking you're kind of cued into to mastery and autonomy, but as the conversation has shifted, implicitly, those three themes have come up over and over. So I just want to point that out. And if you're not familiar with Daniel Pink and Drive, it's a great book for teacher leaders, teachers. And even, you know, as we're thinking about some of these things, mastery, autonomy, and purpose with teachers, we also need to be thinking about how to push that down to the students as well. Because those are three characteristics that would help the students with their motivation also.
Yes, I'm glad that the student voice popping up here in this panel. Actually, in 2011, my thesis was on student voice in Egypt, and it becomes a problem. So, practicality again into the strategy of doing and putting our teachers' voice and student voice into the system, center of our system, and then when we come face the reality of our educational systems, then it is really very.
التي تتدخل في الآن هذه المهارات البيانية والبلاغية التي تتحدث عن البلاغة والمحسنات والتشبيه والمجاز وإلى آخره. طيب شكرا لهذه المداخلة في مجموعة فضل. طب ممتاز أنتم ما شاء الله مقسمين نفسكم يعني الأستاذ يقول لك كنا عليك عن الذكر في نفس الموضوع إلا أنكم ما شاء الله تناولتوا كل المهارات تفضلوا. في تنمية المهارات البيانية والبلاغية ذكرتها الأخت الحاج فعلا لما الطالب يتعلم من نموذج أنا فني أنا يعني الجهد الذي سأقوم أنا كمعلم إني أختار النموذج اللي ممكن الطالب يتعلم منه بشكل سهولة أختار القصة اللي ممكن أطلع منها بأشكال بلاغية تشبيهات استعراض إلى آخره وتكون بشكل بسيط طالب سريعاً يطبق مثلها تفضلي.
دي حاجة تبقى أسهل عندنا في إنجلش نعملها لأن إحنا مش مرتبطين بمنهج فالمدرس بتمشي على كريكولف معين يعني متطلبات معينة بس أنا اللي بختار أو أنا اختار
أنت عندك حرية أكثر من بعض المدارس الأخرى في مدارس مرتبطة
بالعربي عندنا مش مدرس
بس نعم هذا كتير مزار
بناخد
منها فعلا
اول
مبدا
مثلا درس
القراءه
بقسم الدرس
الفكر والفلات واسميه مترجمين. ممتاز، هذه فكره فعلا مهمه لتنميه مهارات حتى ممكن تنميه ايضا المهارات اللغويه الاسلوبيه بهذا الشكل.
بالضبط.
كنت حضرت احد المعلمين ايضا في نفس الزياره في الاردن، انا راجل الاردن ببعض الافكار ايضا. المعلم عامل كتيب صغير بسميه معجم الصغير مع الطالب. هذا المعجم عندما يقرأ كان يقرر عليهم قصص يقرأوها بشكل سنوي، أقصد بشكل دوري. الكلمات الصعبة راح يحطها في الدفتر، الجمل الجميلة راح يحطها أيضا في هذا الدفتر، وفي النهاية هو بيطلب منهم أن يقوموا بعمل إبداعي مختلف تماما باستخدام هذه الثروة اللغوية، وهذه وهي طريقة جدا حلوة يعني للطلاب، أن حتى لأن مجرد أن أنا بمر على الكلمة الطالب يعديها، لكن المفروض أنه يكتبها ويكتب معناها ويقوم باستخدامها في جملة. المهارات الفكرية والتنظيمية، كيف يستطيع الطالب أن ينظم أفكاره ويكتب بتسلسل منطقي؟ يعرف أن في مقدمة، هذه المقدمة لها شكل معين، أنها يجب أن تجذب الجماهير. الله يدور المعلم في اختيار الطريقة، وزي ما راح نتكلم بعد شوية، تقنية واستراتيجية تنمي هذه المهارة بالتحديد، الجزء الجاي ما شاء الله. إزاي أستطيع أن أخلي الطالب يكتب مقدمة تشد الناس؟ يقول لك من العمل الخاص او الى اخره، انا على يقين انا لو فتحت النقاش بس طلعت افكار كثيره للمقدمات والتمهيد، لكن ما عندي مش وقت للاسف.
صعبه لدى الطلاب. ماذا ممكن افعل؟ يعني لو طلبت منه ان اعطيه كلمه يؤلف لي جمله. اعتقد ان كلمه سبات جماليات، حط صفه ضعها، يبدا مضطر انه يقوم بتكوين جمله اخرى وكلمه جمله او كلمات اخرى عشان يكمل لي الفقره كلها. فبعض المدرسين بيكتفي يلا قطع لي هذه الكلمه في جمله، لا اعطيه مساحه اكبر، خليه يفكر بشكل اكبر، اعطيه بعض الاشياء التي تجعله يعني زي ما اخبرتكم شويه يجب يكون فيها حال، فيها صفه، فيها تشبيه معين، فيها صوره معينه.